What is up, Pod Nation? Welcome to the Podio Slate Podcast. Here, as always, with my two music nerd homies, Tony and Anthony. How are you guys doing tonight?
Doing good, man. Are we going to tell the folks that we're now a hip-hop podcast? We're the Hip Pod Podcast?
We should. We should tell everybody. This
hip-hop
is what
heads.
Yeah, this is part two of our ranking the Kanye catalog with Spose. Last week, we had albums 10 through 6. This week we have albums 5 through 1 for the four of us. And it was a blast of a conversation. And we appreciate everybody who checked out part one. We hope you enjoyed that one and had as much fun listening to it as we did putting it together. Spose is a nerd's nerd, so we really enjoyed doing this with him. So let's get into 5 through 1, albums 5 through 1, right now.
Started doing all this rhyming on the side of my assignments back in the day when Mars Volta molded out at the drive-in. Now kaleidoscopic objects doing dances on my eyelids jar. What is happening?
The rhythmic monster.
It's a revolt. I said to put all the hands in the air and they did. It's a cult. I said to burn all the shit to the ground. Do it now because I'm tired of being adult. Fuck the world and its miserable dad. Driving for their cryptocurrency and digital cash. Pay to play. This song is a long and skippable.
Suppose, what do you have at 6?
I think I segued into this segment by saying I had the life of Pablo. So
you
I think we're on to 5.
We're down to 5 now, aren't we, man? I'm glad that someone's paying attention.
I'm happy. Right. I feel like I'm the fourth wheel of this podcast, guys.
No, man. You're right now the point guard. Let's go.
you're the Marcus Smart. You're the captain. You're the face of the
this
franchise.
This is the kindest segment I've ever heard.
Yeah, you're up to 5. Let's do this.
At 5, I got the album Late Registration.
Oh, wow.
It's a fucking amazing album. Second album after College Dropout. It was so incredible at the time. A Gold Digger broke Kanye through to this whole new stratosphere of stardom, you know, that he already kind of had. And then Late Registration, he works with John Bryan of the Fiona Apple, you know, collaboration fame. And it's just a lush, beautiful album. It's a very black man's album, speaking for black people, you know, a lot of this album, and just even more poetically than he did on the first album, which is some of the most poetic shit I've ever heard in my life.
Right.
And it's lush musically. In addition to that, the features, just like he's always done, as he does on Donda, as he did on Pablo, as he's done on Dark Fantasy, the features are of the time. So the features are Adam Levine, like second Maroon 5 album, The Game, the rapper The Game, Paul Wall,
Jamie Foxx, Twista.
Nas, Cameron.
Oh, no, Twista's not on this one.
Cameron, Jamie Foxx, that's on College Dropout, Jamie Foxx and Twista. However, Nas, Cameron, it's crazy. He always finds the best artists of the time. And
Brandy,
fucking cool.
Brandy's on there
Brandy,
too.
That's right. Yeah.
Brandy. I fucking love this album. This is an incredible album, and maybe the peak of like that early Kanye. It's almost like if Graduation was experimental and College Dropout was more musical. You know, it's like that perfect in between of the two of them.
Yeah.
I love the Late Registration. I have 5.
That's a good 5. I'm with you. I have it a little bit higher, and I'll save the rest of my thoughts for it there, but you're right. It's a great record.
What do you got at 5?
Graduation. I got Graduation at 5. And listening to you talk about it earlier, I'm with you. You're right. It's like the culmination of, and it's Graduation, right? You go from College Dropout to Late Registration to Graduation. It is the culmination of this sound of Kanye. And there are some all-time tracks on it. Can't Tell Me Nothing's great. Homecoming's great. The song Big Brother is awesome. I hadn't listened to Big Brother in years. Listening to it back this week, I was like, man, I forgot how much he early on owed Jay, right? And there it is. And he's giving it to you on this record. All of this that I've done, these last 3 albums, thank you, brother. Like, that's why we're here. The Daft Punk, Stronger. It's really glossy. It's really clean. It's really fun. It's not super long, and it's just damn good. And that's all timer.
That song's an all timer.
Yep.
Stronger.
Absolutely. Yep.
Stronger, so good. Right up there with anything Daft Punk ever did.
Yep. Yep.
I think, you know, like, as, and I love Daft Punk.
Same. Yeah. This song actually kind of got me into Daft Punk. My brother was a fan. He kind of told me you should check it out. And then, having heard that, I was like, all right, I'll go back and peep some of that. And I was like, wow, this is really good. And then Alive 2008's great. So yeah, go listen to that too. I've talked about that back on previous pods, but that this is the reason why this Kanye record kind of pushed me towards different stuff, because he of the time, again, pulling people out, getting the best out of them, as you say, like it's, this is what's happening on Graduation. And that's why I've got it at 5.
Contains one of my favorite songs by Kanye, which is Barry Bonds, which a lot of people don't like.
Need apparently. A hit. Yeah. Lil Wayne, right?
Lil Wayne just destroys peak Lil Wayne. It's the Carter free Lil Wayne. It's like
he slays. Oh, he slays on that track. God. Hell yeah. Yeah.
So I also have Graduation at 5. I think it's a, if you look at the trajectory of his catalog, it's a perfect transition evolution from College Dropout to Late Reg to this, but it's also a good segue to what's to come with My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy. There is, I feel like there's some 808's preview stuff going on with like flashing lights. Like it's almost a sign of what's to come.
What a great way to put it. Yeah.
Yeah. And here's the caveat. And we've been talking about this kind of theme. This album would be most rappers' best album by a mile.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, great. and that's the caveat. And I'll be honest with you, I had this album as high or low, however you want to look at it, at 3 as of yesterday. So you can see how this was tough. Damn tough. But I get Graduation 5.
Well, now we're getting into some really difficult territory here, right? Like, how do we rank the last 5?
This is great.
Man, I had 808s at 5. Late Bloomer on this album, similar to what you were talking about, Tone, earlier with Twan. I think we actually all agreed that we hadn't really even really checked out this album, given even a few, like, you know, multiple spins, like literally just really didn't give it a whole time of day. So actually the fact that they got this high of a rank is pretty damn good. But it's time and place again. I remember when it dropped and I remember where I was at. And I think no matter what, I try to separate myself from where I was at the time, but I have to just be myself, right? It's like, it is what it is. So for that reason, you know, even the single Heartless, like that's a killer jam, you know? So yeah, not a whole lot to say other than, you know, it stacks up. He was still in his quote unquote prime. Like he still is in his prime, but he was in a different layer. He wasn't, I don't know, Kanye changed right over the years. So he was still in that kind of like first three-peat going on 4 with a little flair on the side kind of thing. Yeah. So
great description, man. Yeah. That's exactly what it was. It was going on 4. And yeah, it's a little, it's definitely something different. But I think what you said, I just want to piggyback on the back of, because I haven't brought up this album yet, but I wasn't very into this album when it came out either.
Nice.
Like I was like, I bought it and then I think I lost the CD and I never like cared to rebuy it because I don't know, I thought it was cool, but I was like, oh, I don't really like Love Lockdown. It was like a miss for me, you know.
Agree.
And obviously, who doesn't love Heartless? Is you, who doesn't like Bohemian Rhapsody? You know, like who doesn't like? It's a great fucking song, you know. But like, I wasn't that into it early on either.
Yeah, it's one of those weird transition phases where like punk rock is turning into pop punk, and you're like, well, that was cool, but this is cool because this is now. So like, he's like, I don't know, he was still hanging on, but it was like not quite what was going on at the time. So you're kind of like moving on, unfortunately.
Not
where he's changing phases, right? I mean, he went from the trio of the College Trio to, all right, I'm gonna change my sound a little bit. I'm gonna go this
auto-tune
direction. You don't have to like it, but I'm gonna blow this out of the water. And this is what everybody, like Twan said, this is what everybody else is gonna do for the next 10 years because of it. So good luck.
Amen. Yeah. Are we at number 4?
We're at 4. Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. What do you got?
I have an album, a fucking all-time classic album. Up there with anybody's album. At number 4, I have My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy.
Ooh. Wow. Wow. I'm surprised you have it at 4.
Tone's got thoughts.
All right. Yeah. No, Tone's, I mean, I have thoughts. It higher. Yeah. I have it higher.
I think it's common to have it higher. It's fucking classic. It I think it's classic. I don't even think I need to say anything about this album. album speaks for itself.
It really does. You're right.
What needs to be said just from the Nicki Minaj, like narration intro all through the classic song after classic song after classic song all the way through, best artists of the time, lush production. It's really Kanye maximal. It's maximal Kanye. It's the most, it's stadium status Kanye. Art show, My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy with like, I mean, whoo.
Yeah.
Nothing needs more needs to be said. I got it number 4.
I have it at number four too. And
nice.
I think before we jumped on, we were comparing Kanye to like David Bowie. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and this is definitely like the David Bowie, like full on Kanye, like fuck everything. I'm gonna put out a fucking art rock album or art album, you know, whatever. It's concept, it's out there, it's journal entries from 20 years ago, and it's journal entries from 2 days ago. Gorgeous, Monster, Runaway, Lost in the Woods with Bon Iver, like sick, dude, fucking dope as fuck. The fact that it's not higher, I'm actually somewhat regretting right now, but I'm gonna stick by it and not change the album 2 days after it drops, kind of thing. And go with and agree with you. And I think it is a solid number four, but man, it is one of the best albums of all time. And it's like the definition of art, right?
Yep. Agreed. I got it higher. I got more thoughts, but I got it higher. It's so good. It's so good. I'm gonna go four. I'm gonna give you my four. This was really hard for me. I had three and four were very close together, and I flip-flopped all week. I've listened to both records back and forth for like 3 weeks now to try to figure it out. I'm still not sure what I'm going to say right now.
He's flip-flopping right now.
I think it's Late Registration. I think that's what I've got it at four.
Great album.
Yeah, it's the song Gone at the end of the album.
Yeah.
He leads off, right? He gives his verse. We get Cam. And then I forget who the third person on there is.
Nas?
No. I got to look it up. But it's almost like he opens for them and then they're opening for him. His last verse on that song is an all-time Kanye verse. I put it on in the kitchen while my wife and I were making dinner tonight and essentially, you know, didn't do it as well as he does it, but did it. I was like, this is so good. Like this, there's no missed beats on this song. And it's not just that song, right? The whole record's like that. So it's College Dropout, but with a little more experimentation and getting those people to come in and do all the features with him and put out this, really, I think the best of the College trio, if it were the first album he put out, but it's not. So I'm putting it at four, and obviously still have College Dropout to put somewhere a little higher. But yeah, man, it's so good. And there's just so many good Kanye verses on this record. And you're right. Gold Digger is a song that kind of put him into the mainstream. Full disclosure, I work at a high school and they were listening. I heard Gold Digger twice on campus today.
There you go.
And that song. Yeah. And that song's been out, you know, the better part of 20 years. Yeah. So it's like, it still resonates with 16, 17, 18 year olds today. And I was 20, geez, two or three when it came out. So yeah, man, Late Reg four.
What do you got at four?
So I got Late Reg at four as well.
Wow.
This was my intro to Kanye proper. Like I knew College Dropout adjacently, but like I owned Late Reg in the moment, and I listened back and it's got too many skits. It's got too many skits. It like it
broke.
I feel
you
like
got it.
Yeah. And like honestly, like in the context of skits, it's got some all time memorable skits. But
yeah.
Mm-hmm. As far as like a cohesive listen, I think it takes away, like it's just a little too much. And I guess that's my only beef with it, which is, I mean, if my only beef is the skits, like he's doing fucking pretty good.
Yeah.
Touch the Sky. I mean, come on.
Yeah. And it falls short of that, of my top three. I'm not going to say because of the skits, but just because the weight of his catalog, and we'll get into it. But yeah, Late Reg four.
Quick note about, great. I love your analysis of Late Reg, and that's what I call it now as of you saying it, Late Reg, Late Reggie. What was I going to say? There's a moment on Late Registration.
Homie, We Major?
Homie, We Major. I mean, that's a classic.
Is it Drive Slow? I fucking love Drive
Slow.
No.
Shit. It's Touch the Sky. Touch the Sky, which you just
Touch
referenced.
The Sky. Yeah, yeah.
Touch the Sky is a gospel song. I'm trying to testify. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Look at Extra Fly. It's like it hit me totally different now after hearing Donda and Jesus is King. I was like, oh, this is all fucking, you know, but I mean, back with Slick Rick, I mean, his verse, I don't need the Lupe Fiasco verse on that even.
Kanye, I agree. Totally agree.
And you're right. And the video even kind of hides it from you. He's Kanye Evel Knievel style, right? He's actually literally touching the sky.
And Pamela Anderson.
Yeah, yeah. Great. Just a great record. I love Drive Slow too. I love that whole, you had tweeted out lyrics for that today. And we were all
tonight,
like, yes.
Yeah, because I was just re-listening to it.
I was like, I think that's because he's listening to it because he's gonna come talk to us. Yeah, this is awesome.
Registration some time tonight because I was like, oh, am I discounting it? Is it bad? And I was like, oh, it's perfect. It's just, you know, but
there's yeah. more. Yeah,
yeah,
but it's so much.
Are we at number?
We're at number three. What do you got for three?
Someone else go three.
My three. This is another flip flop. I had this different before, but thinking about it today, I moved it back down. I have Life of Pablo at three. It was like Nate said, it was like, I was a huge fan. I had always paid attention. This is kind of the start of the, I'm going to drop it this day and then it doesn't come out. Right. Kanye.
Yeah.
Right. And then they dropped yeah. The streaming service title was kind of involved, and I may or may not have paid for a month of title so I could listen to Life of Pablo because I needed it before I had to wait for it to hit Apple Music. And
guilty.
Yeah, started the streaming, you know, streaming wars and all that shit. And I'm like, I remember being super hyped about it because it was like, I'm ready for a new Kanye record. I want to hear this. I can't wait to hear what he does after Yeezus and all of the hype around it. I was trying to put away and I had it higher because of that. But I think the hype around it, it may have detracted from it a little bit, and the changing of it may have detracted from me a little bit. Listening to it again this week, I've noticed the changing of Wolves. I think the original version of Wolves is better, but that's just me. I mean, that's subjective. It's still a great song. I love 30 Hours. I love No More Parties in LA. I love Famous. I love Ultralight Beam. It's just a great record. And you're right. It's just a little bit too long as far as keeping it a little bit higher. But I mean, I have it at three. It's one of his best records to date. And man, it's one that I come back to. Yeah. Of the last five, it's one that I come back to the most.
So, Nate, do you or Spose have Life of Pablo at three?
No.
So, I do.
Spose already had it, too.
Oh, that's right.
Do? All right, Twan, what do you got?
So, I have it at three. Special, special album for me. Like, I remember I was all over this when it dropped. The only reason I don't have it higher is because of the first half of the album. The second half of this album is his best piece of work collectively. Waves into FML into Real Friends, which Real Friends is top five. I mean, as someone who's closer to 40 than 30, listen to the lyrics of Real Friends. They hit. It's like, dude, were you in my fucking brain when you wrote that?
Yeah.
Into Wolves, into 30 Hours, a couple tracks later. That run, I think, is his best run. I think it's his best run. And it was personally my intro to Post Malone with Fade. And then I love just Panda being in the middle of part two. It's just like, wait, what?
Yeah, right. It's so good.
And I'm trying to think, like,
Designer.
Designer. Had that come out yet? I can't remember.
It was like underground. Kanye is the only reason anybody knows about Panda.
Yeah.
Panda. And he was like, oh, we got to flip this.
You know, it's funny. Earlier tonight, I suppose you said he gets the most out of his features. Every record we've talked about, the features are all untouchable. And this is another one of those situations where it made that kid for a minute, you know, because of how big it was.
Yeah.
All over. I mean, everybody. Yeah. The feature, like you said, you had Post Malone. This is before Post Malone was Post Malone.
Yep.
He saw Post Malone early.
Yeah. This was like concurrent with White Iverson. It was 2016. It was right at the same time, I feel like, or it could have been before. But again,
Sia. He's got Sia on it.
Oh, that's right. Yep. Yeah.
Damn. Yep.
Great features.
But same thing as Late Reg. Like, this would be most of everyone's favorite rapper's best album by a mile.
Yep.
All right, man. What do you have at three?
I actually ranked this one way higher than you guys. I had Graduation at number three.
Nice.
And out of all Kanye albums, I got to admit right now, I've spent more time with this album than anything that Kanye has ever put out. I had just moved to New York City when this dropped in 07. And I always reference 07 with our nerd talk. I don't know if you know this, Spose, but like, that's when the iPhone came out. So like everything about music appreciation just like fucking changed. Cause now you can just
life changed right then. I had a baby right around then. That was
shit.
It was my whole, it was a big change. I remember it.
Yeah. It was a big paradigm shift in just everything, but technology wise and how you play music. And I just got into the big city. I was living in Manhattan and then Brooklyn. And I'm like, fuck, this album drops. I'm living with a guy. You guys know him, Devin. And we played this album literally on repeat every fucking day. Like, we just wore it out. I think the album, like, at one point, and we were still playing CDs, like, literally stopped like working. It was like so fucking burnt out. And because of that, it holds a very strong place in my heart, and all the songs that I know verbatim. I mean, you got Good Morning, Champion, Stronger, I Wonder, Can't Tell Me Nothing, one of my favorite rap songs of all fucking time. Flashing yeah. Lights, Everything I Am is a slow jam for rap. Woo! Sick.
What the big, fuck? The lyrics. Big, so good.
Yeah. Big Brother, just props to Jay-Z, someone that we came up on to hear someone talk about him in that light. Killer. Just so fucking sweet. And just, I think it was part of the fact that I was living in New York City, so I kind of the whole Jay-Z connection, obviously, and his line with on Big Brother about Madison Square Garden. He actually played Madison Square Garden for the first time as a headliner for the Glow in the Dark tour. So like to say like he wanted to go on that show and he couldn't do it, and then he finally headlined himself. I was like, dude, like you fucking made it. You did it, you know?
Yeah.
And to live that in the moment while listening to it, have him be like, his assistant wouldn't even give me two tickets. And then like 4 months later, he's headlining. I think he headlined like six nights at Madison Square Garden with like Rihanna and NERD, and it was a stacked lineup. But I was living in Kanye to the fullest extent, like in this moment. So like I almost put it, I had it at number one a few times and I had to change it, but I was like, damn, this album, like I know it so strong and lived it in the moment. Saw him at Bonnaroo when he came out at like fucking 4 a.m. or something.
Yeah, you did?
Yeah. It was Kanye in his craziest moment, but living it, you know, Michael Jackson style, the top of his game. So it was pretty cool.
Wow, what a story, man. That is fucking awesome. And as I said, when I ranked Graduation at 8 in this listing, I had a great time of my life when Graduation came out. The way you described it, it reminds me that this album is the graduation, as you guys put it. This is when Kanye became a full-on superstar, classic album, perfect album, perfect era, starts to expand on his thing. He's starting to make maybe sneakers with Nike or something. You know, it's like it's all beginning to happen. The early, like, when you have to climb up to the top of the mountain to start to, like, kick some ass and like make some moves, like he did it right there, you know. And everything since has been, you know, because of Graduation, because of that crowning achievement, Graduating.
Yeah, he was still attainable. Like I was living in New York, he did a meet and greet at not Virgin Megastore, but the other one, one of them, and I actually got to meet him really quick and he signed something. I can't find that signature, but and he does like this bear signature. I'm like, dude, this is so fucking OG. And like now, like meeting Kanye like at a meet and greet and for an in-store is like, fuck, forget about it, you know?
Not gonna happen. So
it was such time and place. It's crazy.
So at 3, I have The College Dropout. This album is fucking perfect. It's another Dark Twisted Fantasy level classic album, front to back, everything. We Don't Care, from We Don't Care, you know, all the way to Last Call with him telling the story. I mean, this is an all-timer. The big reason this for me is at number 3 is that this album, much like many Kanye albums, changed everything. It changed everything. Mos Def was never rapping with Freeway.
Right.
It was never happening, ever. Like, Jay-Z was never on the same album as, like, John Legend, who nobody'd ever heard of, only because he was on The College Dropout did they hear of him. You know, like, it's just crazy. It's crazy. It's an all-timer. I love this album personally. I was like a junior, senior in high school when this album came out. Same time as like Get Rich or Die Trying by 50 Cent, you know, like this era. And this Kanye album, I had the leak of it early because I was really a big Jay-Z fan at this time. So I was very into anybody who's associated with Jay-Z MP3s. So I had the leak of the Kanye West album and he changed it before it ever came out. That was the first time I was ever acquainted with the first album ever. He changed it before I heard the final version. So it's like, I guess he's been doing it from the jump. There was way more interludes. There was there's an old Dirty Bastard song called Keep the Receipt. That's an all time classic. But this album speaks for itself. This is a big time moment in rap history.
Is this the first album of all time to have three skits in 4 tracks?
You could be right.
With School Spirit into School Spirit into School Spirit into Lil Jimmy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Damn. Wow, he's really breaking the mold.
Spose is like, I get some ideas now. Jeez, I get
shit. My album's 19 skits, 1 song.
Yeah, 1 song. Gotta find it.
It's an album, though.
Every week you put out a new album and you just move where the song is.
The skit. Yeah.
I had it at 2. We'll jump into 2s now. I had it at 2, College Dropout. I went back and forth between this and Late Registration being 3-4 for a while, and I was like, no, this is what introduced me to Kanye. I remember where I was when I first heard it. I remember who I was with when I first heard it. I remember being like, yo, let me borrow that so I can burn that shit because I don't have any money. I'm a broke college kid. Like, I need this in my life. Let's go. And it was a tonal shift in hip hop. It made what he was doing the mainstream, and nobody was doing what he was doing at the time. So it was just so good. And it goes back to the features, everybody on there putting together Most Def and Freeway, you know, whether it's Quali or Quilly, I put him on tracks with Jay-Z. Like, yeah, okay, let's go.
Yeah.
And I knew who Quali was at the time, but not everybody else did.
No. Nope.
So I was like, sweet, let's go. Yeah. It was just so good. And man, like School Spirit, I love listening to School Spirit. I'm a freshman in college. I'm like, yes, this makes sense to me. Like, I feel like I'm also in college and I don't know if I want to be here either. Like, let's figure out what we want to do with our lives. But shit, man, it was just so good. It was the introduction to Kanye for me. I remember all about everywhere, everything about it, where I was, all that stuff. Kind of similar to what your story, Nate, with Graduation. You know exactly where you were. You remember who you were with, that whole thing. It's a feeling. It's a vibe. And that's why I have it at 2. It's so damn good.
Yo, can I just run through some of the songs on College Dropout?
Yes.
We Don't Care. I mean, that sums up everything so Kanye has ever done since then, right out the gate. It's the perfect first song. All Falls Down.
Fuck. Classic.
Top ever song.
I wrote that down. Just says it. Says All Falls Down dash classic. Like, yeah.
All time classic.
And Lauryn Hill wrote it with Kanye. Yeah.
Wow. That so I've good. Been working this grave.
Yeah. Yep.
Oh man. And it Jesus Walks. Never Let Me Down with Jay-Z. Get Him High with Talib Kweli. The fucking new workout plan. Slow jams. I mean, stop.
There's two words.
Fire.
Through the Wire, Last Call. Fuck, dude. Like,
Jesus.
Like, even Last Call is like a ramble, but that fucking freestyle at the end, fuck.
Nobody could argue with this at number one.
No, you're right.
Yeah.
Yep.
This is fire.
Totally.
All right. At number two, I have 808s and Heartbreak.
Ooh, so I know what your one is. Okay. Okay.
Good job, Twan.
We'll wait.
Good deduction. Yeah, this album also, like I said, I wasn't very into it when it came out. I have since bought it 2 times, physical CD, and it is an all-time fucking classic, right up there with Dark Twisted Fantasy, College Dropout, everything. In my opinion, this album is when, this is right after Graduation, this is right after he ascended to the peak, he goes way left field.
Yep.
He goes way left field, but it's only left field for the time. Cause when you listen to it now, everybody's doing that shit. It was only left field. Like you said, it gave birth to Drake. It gave birth to Kid Cudi. It gave birth to all this whole genre, Travis Scott, you know, everything came out of 808s and Heartbreak, completely shifting everything way left field. I think, was this right after his mom died?
He broke up with Amber Rose, I think, too, right? There was a lot of stuff happening.
He broke up with his long-term girlfriend, and now he's, like, with Amber Rose.
Okay, yeah. He was going through a breakup. I knew that.
Yeah.
I think his mom did die. I think that's right.
I think she did, and it's just the heaviest, most pop, most left-field production, most daring, most auto-tune. Like, nobody's doing any of this shit to this degree, and now everybody was doing this shit by, like, 2015. You know, like it was just years and years ahead of its time and just changed everything. And I think it was the first indication we got of who this guy was for real, like what this guy was prepared to do.
You're right. She died in November of 2007. And this came out after.
Yeah. So this is a heavy, fucking serious album that has every song is a classic.
Again, I'm a late bloomer with it. If we do this segment again, this exact segment next year, I'll probably have it ranked differently. But it did. It changed the trajectory. And if you look across like the landscape of music, across the history of music, I don't know. Like, this has got to be top 5, 10 of just shifting the whole industry. And
he's done it 3 times. He's done it 4 times.
I mean, who else would have done this? You know what I mean? You got to put your neck out for this, because it's like this could shit its pants or be the future of music.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Boom. And I think it was the future of music.
Yeah, man. What do you got at two?
Yeah, what do you got at two, Twan?
So I got My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy. Brilliant album, obviously, if it's two. Again, it's one of those, if you look across his catalog, Kanye as an artist couldn't have made this album up until this point. Like, 808s had to happen for this album to drop. Like, if this came after Dropout, it would have been like, all right, who does this guy think he is, you know? But it's a super right, cohesive yeah. album. There's no skits on it. And I know I keep bringing up skits, but, like, there's no skits or interludes to my recollection. And I think it has my favorite Kanye song of all time, which is All the Lights. Perfect song. Perfect features. Yep. So perfect good. Video. You got Hype Williams on the direction.
Woo.
I mean, you got Cudi, you got Rihanna, you got Fergie. Damn. I don't know.
What do you need?
What do you,
Elton Bond's so allegedly on it.
Oh, is he really? Yeah. I mean, it just, allegedly. I'm not saying that carries it, but damn. I think it's his best song. It's probably the only Kanye song that I'll just like be walking the dog at 8 p.m. at night and be like, all right, All the Lights is coming on. Yeah.
Yeah. Here we go.
Here we go. Yeah. But yeah.
Love it.
Number two.
Love it.
Man.
Two.
Yeah, we get two, Nate.
I like that. Number two for me, we've talked about it at length tonight, but I'm going College Dropout for number two. This was my proper introduction to Kanye. I guess you could say I was a late bloomer. I mean, it's his second album.
You're not.
But, yeah. I mean, we're all the, you know, same age group, so we kind of discovered him at different times, close to when he was coming out, or at least getting big, but in one way or the other, we're introduced by him. But yeah, dude, this fucking album, opening track is sick. Just that beat alone, All Falls Down. You mentioned all this, Spose, but All Falls Down, Jesus Walks, Never Let Me Down, The Towel Blind and Get Them High is just like all time. Woo. Even the girl talking, like lyrics stick to my rib. I'm like, damn, dude, that's so fucking, it's just perfect. Slow Jams, Two Words. I was texting with these guys last week. Just that guitar lick in Two Words, for some reason, just that's money. Like that yeah. little tiny
yeah,
sample
yeah, yeah,
is like
yeah, yeah.
Through the Wire. I just like that. Anything, any music that has any kind of like real time or real life autobiography type artistic flow to it. I love that shit because it's behind the music type stuff. You know, he's like the Vanilla Skyline in that song alone. It's just like you get the visual right away, you know? And again, I think I mentioned earlier, just the whole storyline. We call it nerdery on here. Like everything that he spits on Last Call is like, dude, I feel like he's on the podcast right now, just telling us some backstory.
Telling the story.
Yeah.
And after revisiting that after, I don't even know, 15 years. And now that we're in this whole like interview, like music journalism mode, I'm like, dude, he's really telling some pretty good backstory on this album right now. This is sick. So this actually ping ponged from one and two for the last 2 days, but I'm going to put it at two for right now, at least.
Are we at number one?
We're at one.
Yeah.
I just want to say about the line you brought up, I look like Tom Cruise in Vanilla Sky.
Yeah. So
Matt, do you remember, like, people forget, we forget because we're so used to it, but like the things Kanye was saying, nobody was saying in rap. Nobody was saying any of that.
Yeah.
Nobody was talking about half the things he was referencing in songs. You know, he's talking about like things on the internet, like, you know, and like he's talking about rappers nobody's talking about on Rockefeller, you know. It was very crazy. Yeah,
the best analogies ever. Now you're Jennifer Aniston, you're like, oh shit.
First big line, I feel like, got a light skin friend, look like Michael Jackson. Like that was his first line that was like, what?
Yeah.
Who comes up with that? All right, number one, who's going?
You're up.
And number
I think
one,
we know it too. Yeah.
At number one, I have Yeezus.
Explain yourself. Explain yourself.
Nice.
Yeah, I mean, Yeezus to me is the quintessential Kanye album because it's the most indicative of like what he's willing to do for art. And like this, but beyond that, I mean, beyond the metaphorical, symbolical, whatever, this album fucking slays. This album just gets me fucking hype. I love everything about it. As soon as On Sight drops, as soon as I Am New Slaves, I mean, this is the hardest core. This is the drug right into the vein version of Kanye West. No fucking frills about it. No, my dark. Well, because the big context is the Taylor Swift incident at the VMAs preceded My Dark Twisted Fantasy. Kanye had to hit a 10 out of 10.
Right.
He had to hit a unanimous, perfect, artsy, but epic rap classic album to win back everybody's approval. And he did it. And then he made Yeezus with Daft Punk in Paris, you know, and he made the fucking crazy. He had Chief Keef with Bon Iver.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Is that who it was? Yep. Together on the same song? I mean, that's freeway in most death.
Right.
But on crack, right. That's like, that's the vision. That's the drug. I mean, it's just Yeezus is raw Kanye West. However, it's hypersexualized. It's like offensive. It's like, I put my first song, he's like, put my dick in her mouth. And like, on sight, you know, and it's just very hard and very crazy. But like, just the daring to do it, you know, at that level, to blow it all up after he earned back to everybody's love, is for to make, in my mind, an album where he goes from the hero's journey of this shitty asshole character to Bound 2 with Kim Kardashian.
Right.
In the what is it, Ed Hardy look commercial looking video. You know, it's like, yeah. It's incredible, you know, the way he didn't give a fuck.
Well, I think context is king. It's like he comes off My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy. If he dials back to College Dropout, that's a weird move. You almost got to push it to the next realm, and this is the next realm. And like, I mean, I had it at 8, so it just shows the, you know, the
totally. That's a common perspective. I think that is a lot of people's, because at the time it's very abrasive.
Yep.
And now it's very abrasive, I guess.
Well,
you know,
it starts off on SNL. It was like, I remember thinking, what the hell am I looking
at? Yeah.
Man.
Because the SNL for Dark Fantasy was perfect. Do you remember the Power one where he had like all the, it was the first time you saw like artsy Kanye at SNL. He made the whole backdrop white and he was standing up on like stairs with like a million chains on. And there was all these like girls in red doing, you know, it was like crazy. But yeah, so I think that concludes my defense of Yeezus.
I got to revisit it. I think that's the takeaway for me.
Please. It's so fun. It's so hardcore. And it's so black. It's a very black album. It's about being a black man. See a black man with a white woman at the top floor. They're going to come like your King Kong. Middle America packed in, came to see me and my black skin. Number one question they ask him, fuck every question they ask him.
Damn.
It's just, it's hardcore. You know, it's like Sex Pistols in a way, you know, like.
Yeah.
It's when Kanye went punk.
It really is. I mean, and it is a lot of Daft Punk, but like for me, this signifies where he was headed from here on out. He's totally disruptive.
Yep.
He's breaking the mold. He's building fucking whatever he wants. Okay, so that's my number one. What do you guys got?
I had to say one thing, like what you just said just now almost goes directly to his line where he's like, certain powers that be won't let me get my ideas out. It's like, yeah, he's been holding in that shit for so long.
Yep.
Right. And he's like, now fuck y'all. Like, I'm gonna put this shit out now. You know, I made it. I've officially made it. I'm gonna just say what I want. And you gotta get there, you know. So
well, and that line's from Gone, and that line's off Late Registration, and it really does, it really is him down the road. He's saying, I'm ahead of my time, sometimes years out. And he's proven that. He did it with 808s. He's done it with Pablo. He's done it with, you know, when in 5 years from now, when someone's doing that idea that we came up with, where they're putting a record out and they're changing it every couple of weeks and giving it to you again. Like Kanye did that in 2016. He did it with Dropout. So he did that in 2004. So he's ahead of his time. He's always been that way. And Yeezus is another one of those situations, I think, where he definitely is, you know, ahead of his time and giving you something different that you weren't ready for and wasn't mainstream at the time, but is going to be. Deal with it.
Taylor Swift literally did it like the next album.
Yep.
Right.
It was like the.
Yep. Yep.
Like Taylor Swift album. It's like, what? Okay.
Yep.
We know, I've heard this. I like it. I'm ready for it. I actually like Taylor Swift's version of it too. But yeah. All right. Number one.
I had fantasy at number one. It's cliche. I know it. I get it. I mean, it is the perfect combo. It's so good. Like there's no wasted space.
Yep.
You know, it's just so damn good from front to back. It continues the trend of him having absolutely perfect features from everybody that came in. He gave you this piece of art. I think if we didn't hear Power Everywhere for the last, I don't know what, 11 years, 12 years, if we didn't hear that everywhere, we'd think that is his best song ever, or it would be, you know, top two or three. And it still is. I mean, go back. You mentioned the Dissect podcast. That was the first one I ever listened to, was the deep dive on that record. And I had already been a huge fan. I remember listening to it a ton when it came out. Anthony, we were living together. I probably made you listen to it more than you wanted to at the time. And I was just like, this is so good. I don't understand. This is going to be one of the best records of all time down the road. Like, it's just so friggin' deep, and there's so much to it. And then listening to that podcast, it gave me a whole nother perspective on it that I didn't even have from just listening to it in the moment when it came out. So, you know, shouts to the Dissect podcast, but man, it is just so good from front to back. There's not, like I said, not a wasted spot. And that's why it's number one. I mean, there's just so many good songs on there and so many good uses of other people, and the production is great, and it doesn't end. There's no, I could talk about it for 4 hours. How good this album is.
There's like there's like 10 songs on this album you could pull out and be like, that's the best Kanye West song.
Yep.
Runaway.
Yep.
I mean, Devil in a New Dress.
Yep. Yep. There's just so many.
Rick Ross comes in with a feature like 6 minutes in after a guitar solo.
And then, Chris Rock at the end of it. Right.
Oh, dude. I listened to that today. Fuck yeah.
Yeezy taught me. Yeah.
Right. Yeezy taught me. That Blame Game with John Legend.
Oh, so good. Blame Game is. Yeah. Blame Game got me through some tough times.
Yeah. Dark Fantasy is a perfect album. Yep. It's just perfect.
All right. What'd you guys have at one?
All right. One, I had College Dropout. I think a lot of where I'd go has been said. I mean, it's got rappy Kanye, it's got melody Kanye, it's got harmony Kanye. Again, broken record. The skits, they don't hold up for me, but that doesn't take away from the album. And I think this is like this interesting intersection where, again, context is king. If you were an Atmosphere head or a Black Star head or Idea and Abilities, or on the other end of the spectrum, Jay-Z, Nas, like, this was the perfect fucking fusion where it was like, all right, here's backpack rap, but with major label production. Mm-hmm. I'm here for this. And I was like a couple of years late. I didn't get into this in 04. I got into this in like 05, 06. But it just, if someone put out this album today, it would set the fucking world on fire. And I don't know what it would sound like for the current time, but man, for the time, it was untouchable. And I think it still holds up. That's why it's one.
Totally.
Yeah, I agree with that. In fact, what your sentiment on that one is, for my number one, Late Registration. A, I got into Kanye at this time, 05. B, I got to say, like we were mentioning earlier, 07 was kind of like when we had access to information via the iPhone. That invention changed the whole dynamic of access to info. So like, 05, it's still organic. So I got to say, it has an effect on music production trends, like deadlines, everything. Like if it's before 07, there's a different feel to almost all music that was, you know, that dropped before 2007. It's just the way it is. Like there's just a different feel. Like, you know, that even the promotion methods are tangible. Like, oh, like we know this works. This is proof of concept. So for like Late Registration, it comes out after College Dropout. They already knew that he had something going on. So now they got these features that are, I think you said it, Spose, already kind of the time. So they know that like this will work, but how is it going to work? And Kanye made it work on this album, which is fantastic. Opening with, you know, I Heard Him Say with Adam, Touch the Sky. Lupe's rap on that is just classic. Gold Digger was literally everywhere you went, right?
Yeah.
Call it mainstream, we'll call it whatever, but that track is just actually has that Kanye education Nas kind of thing where it's like you're actually learning something at the same time, something that hits home, which I have always appreciated in hip hop, especially with Nas, just because it's like, all right, this guy actually is like a Zach De La Roca, Rage Against the Machine. Like, I'm actually learning some shit. This is awesome. You know, fuck you.
Wow. That's one of the coolest things I've ever heard said about him. That's a great comparison.
Oh, it's a new respect for hip hop or any artist that actually gives you an education that you don't get in school through music, which is why it's so sacred, you know, like speak the truth. you know, freedom of speech is such a, is so sacred in music for that reason. And then you got My Way Home, Common's Line in that, Bring Me Down. The production on that song is fucking killer. Diamonds Are Forever with the Jay-Z, the second version, like timeless. Like Jay-Z slays on that. That's like fucking Renegade with Eminem and Jay-Z. Like he owns that song over Kanye. You know what I mean? It's just so fucking, those bars are just dope. And I got a second
moment. The day I heard that song was a moment at work.
Oh yeah.
Fair in Wells selling Moody, selling fish.
Yeah.
That song. There was this like, oh man, we listened to it on the speaker over and over on some, on a burned CD.
Yep.
That's the energy, like, oh, the energy of that song, man.
The energy of that song. That's like the only time I've ever been like, Jay-Z is the greatest of all time. Like when I heard that, I'm like, he is the greatest of all time. I actually retract that now, but when hearing that, I'm like, he is fucking on his game. And I got to agree with you, Tone, earlier, Gone, probably in my top three favorite hip hop songs of all time. Yep. And I got to say the biggest reason, again, Kanye kills it on that song, but Cameron's fucking line in that song is fucking maybe my best line in any hip hop song of all time. He's the most underrated hip hop artist of all time. Cameron, like that song is fucking sick.
You mad. Yep. You mad.
Yeah.
I love Cameron.
Yep. So, oh, dude. Yep. So good.
Have a song called Down and Out on Cameron's album from that era that is also right up there with everything on College Dropout. Fire. Is that conclude our countdown?
That's one.
I think it does.
Damn.
That's one for everybody.
Great job, guys. Straight Kanye nerdery. This was a great conversation. This was great.
Oh, so much fun
to do it. This is awesome.
So let's circle back to what we started with. You got the album dropping on 10/20. So a couple of weeks from now, go cop that. And also get tickets if you're local to Maine or in the New England region, get tickets to PDank Xmas. That's December 18th, right? With the Flowbots.
Correct. With Flowbots down at Aura, we're going to be putting on a show.
Nice. Can't wait. Hell yeah. Can't wait for all that.
Brilliant.
Is that full band, Spose, with the humans?
Yeah, we got the full band. Yeah, we got it all. All the bells and whistles.
Nice.
So with all the Christmas bells.
Travis Barker on drums as a replacement.
I'm just kidding. Hoping so.
He's hanging out with MGK licking their wounds.
I emailed Slipknot. I asked him.
Jay Weinberg's gonna play drums.
Yeah. But yeah, man, album's coming out, you know, October 20th. But so happy to be back on the podcast, man. Always a good time.
Yeah. I'm sure we'll hit you up again. You never know.
I got other albums I can count down. But yeah, man. Long live Kanye, long live Patio Slave Podcast. Thank you guys again.
Thank you.
Awesome. Thanks for coming on, man.
Thanks, brother. Nerds, nerd.
Nerd on.
All right, folks, there you have it. Rankings 5 through 1 of the Kanye West catalog. That was fucking awesome. Like, Spose, we got a taste of, you know, who he is as a person, as an artist. The first time he was on back in episode 29, him coming back to do this with us, it was just like shooting the shit with one of the guys. I have a few overlying takeaways after doing that exercise, but I want to hear you guys. Like, what's your aha moments? What surprised you about the whole exercise?
I mean, I think I'm just speaking generally, but to be able to go into a deep dive with some friends and a guest and really dissect these albums, you know, on the granular level is quite the exercise in itself. So to hear different opinions and different little tidbits on certain parts of songs or certain guests and have what they offer, you know, what they bring to that song is a nerd's dream. So I thought that was really cool. And for come back on and cite as a hip hop MC, you know, brings it up another level. I think we talked about that last time, but I can't get over it just because it's like, you know, he puts the sauce. So he makes the sauce too. So he gives it another and a level of a professionalism that, you know, we can only speak to half what he knows.
Right. Yeah. He not only is he a fan like we are, he, you know, he knows how to make beats, he knows how to play guitar, he knows how to put together hip hop songs, and he's been doing it for quite a while now. So to hear, and not just hip hop songs, right? He's got some kind of alternative radio background as well. But man, to hear him come at it from a different angle than the three of us do, and to it was the perfect, he's a perfect person to have on for something like that, because it just fit what he does and who he is as a fan and what we do and who we are as fans. We kind of all, like I said, he's a nerd's nerd. Like he's into the little things that we're into and wants to like break down, you know, the, what the tonal change from Graduation to 808s, right? Like, it's just stuff like that that we pay attention to and talk about every week. And to have somebody on who is also in the game and, you know, is a creator himself and has put out some bangers on his own, really cool to have on with us and spend, you know, 2+ hours talking Kanye West.
Totally. I get a few thoughts, and one of them I just thought of hearing you guys chat is like the fact that he's an MC. It's almost like the player turned coach, and the player, his players respect him more because he was a player, or the movie critic that was a director. You know, it's not just some schlub giving you their opinion like we are. He comes from a background that, you know, his opinion carries some weight. And I guess that's a good segue into, I need to revisit Yeezus, clearly. I mean, he had it right. One, like, and that's on me. And I'm not saying that's like the best, it's like known as the best album of all time, but it's critically acclaimed, you know, by a lot of folks. And the other takeaway is 808s. That's one that, and I knew that going into this. I knew that was a me thing, but I am going to spend more time with it. Those two, I feel like I owe a little more respect.
Yeah, that's another thing about this exercise. It forces you to reanalyze certain parts of albums or just full on records on in the entirety. So, you know, maybe you skipped over it a few years back. Like, this gives you the opportunity to really dissect that. Yeah, coming from Spose, especially, I mean, we can't get away from it. He, you know, we bring it to a certain level and he's able to kind of carry that torch and go full circle on everything production wise. If anything, I realized how talented Kanye West is. I know he's obviously very popular, but there was a phase there where I thought he was a little overrated. And after going on a deep dive on his whole catalog, I was like, God, this guy really deserves every prop he's ever gotten. He is a genius. Even on the stuff that I was less familiar with, I'm like, this is, I mean, all his albums are just pure art.
Yeah, totally. And it's wild. We all had Yeezus pretty low, the three of us, and Spose had it high. And Nate, you said the Dissect podcast. I was DMing with Spose a little bit after we got done talking, maybe a day or two out, and he was like, go listen to that. They do a really good job of explaining it. And he said, better than I could. So, and you know, that podcast is dope, and it's done a really good job. I listened to the My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy one, and he just, yeah, it's great. You know, once you're done listening to us, go listen to that one if you want to hear another version talking about Kanye. But Yeezus is like what you said, Anthony. It's the toughest hang, but also the best thing ever. And I think he put it well. It is Kanye, like, unfiltered. It's like in your face, Kanye, to the nth degree. And some people didn't like that in the moment, but over time, I think it's definitely grown on a lot of people. And then even myself, like, I like it more today than I did when I first listened to it, for sure. There's a lot more there for me than there was, you know, when it dropped. I was like, really? This is what we get? And now I'm like, okay, I get it. This was the only thing he could have done. So, yeah, really fun to have Spose's perspective on all that stuff.
Yeah, man, I agree with you on that.
All right. Thank you for listening to all of that, guys. We really appreciate everybody that's taken the time to listen to our countdown of the Kanye West catalog with Spose. Check out Spose. Go to sposemusic.com. He has an album dropping on 10/20. So a couple of, you know, a little over a week from now when you're hearing this. And he's also got a show, I think, in Boston a couple days later. And then he's also got P-Dank Xmas 7, which is in Portland, Maine, at Aura in Portland, Maine, on December 18th with the Flowbots, which I didn't even know that those guys are still active. So that's pretty cool. Pretty stoked for that. I have not been to a P-Dank Xmas. I plan on going to this one if all works out for me. So yeah, go check all that stuff out and, you know, follow him on the socials. He's been a big promoter of our stuff, and we really appreciate that from him. So yeah, exciting stuff, guys. Till next week.
See you, everyone. We'll see you next week, and go grab Spose's action figure.
Cheers, nerds.
Peace, buttheads. When I walk out the crib, I got a piss, but they're all on my dick these days. Feel plus, no minus these days. Can I get my shine in for Pete's sake? For Pete's sake. Let me take it back. I remember when nobody ever heard of him. My mom worked at Burger King. My dad was a cable guy. We wondered how we ate at night. And then they got divorced. I was crying when they said goodbye. I love you guys. Throw your food stamps in the air if you empathize. Now I run an enterprise. You know what I symbolize. Even if I die, I will never die. Opposite of 9/11, feeling like November 9th. November 9th.
cause I got that shit that make Rick Ross go, make Jay-Z go, make Kanye go. I know you're at a loss for words. What could you say? I used to drive in a Cutlass, heat never worked though. Back door busted, climbing from the first row. Took it to the back seat, didn't bother me none. Mom worked two jobs, I was on free lunch. If you want an update, I ain't got no downtime. High digging 45s, added up this cloud nine. I think I made a difference with the mic now. I'm making suicidal kids put the knife down. Cause I worked for so hard so long that I deserve to feel this good. They said we couldn't, but what if we could? They said we wouldn't, but we knew we would. P-Dang, making plus out of minus these days. And I don't got no work shirt or briefcase. And no name tag, it's the same cat. Put your mane on a map and I'm back.
I got that shit that make Rick Ross go. Make Jay-Z go.
Yep,
Kanye go.
I've been spitting with the viciousness. I've been adding to my dividends. I've been repping all the villages for all of my constituents and everyone applaud. Big Sean go.
Oh God.
Make 2 Chainz go. Make Jada Kiss go. Make Biggie go. Make French Montana go. Never thought it would be like this. Never thought I'd MC like this. To the point where I walk up in the restaurant, the chef come out the kitchen and he give me free trees like this. He's a keep repping me like this. I said I will, I'll be the people's douche until the day that I get killed. And I don't got no land plot full of crops, drop top yacht by the dock. You know what I got, I got
that shit that make Rick Ross go, make Jay-Z go, make Kanye go. I know you're at a loss.